I'd like to introduce our two speakers who we have online today. We've got Associate Professor Lorraine Smith, and she's a research psychologist at the University of Sydney. Her research interests are patient experiences of long-term conditions, self-management and goal setting. And we've got Anne McKenzie, who's worked as a health consumer advocate since 1995 and is now the head of the Western Australian Consumer and Community Health Research Network. Her task is to implement a statewide consumer and community involvement program in research organisations across the Western Australian Health Translation Network. She serves as a consumer representative for Consumers Health Forum of Australia and is a former chair of Health Consumers Council Western Australia and serves on key state and national health committees. In 2015, Anne was appointed to the Order of Australia for service in the area of health consumer advocacy. So, firstly, I'd like to hand over now to Lorraine Smith, who's going to be speaking to us about patient consent and HealthTalk Australia.
Okay, thanks very much, Kate, and good afternoon, everyone. It's lovely to be with you, and I understand I have about 10 minutes to take you through a bit of a tour of consent issues that we have had to organise over the last 10 or so years when it comes to getting consent for video and audio recorded interviews that we conduct as part of our research. But first of all, I'd just like to take you through a couple of websites, but before I do that, I'll just tell you briefly about this sort of work that I do, and then I want to give you a quick tour of a couple of websites that, so you can have a look at the sorts of video and audio recordings that we provide to the public, and then I want to take you through our consent and copyright forms, which I hope will sort of give you a little more background about the sorts of the types of consent that we get from our participants. So the sort of work part, some of the work that I've been doing over the last 10 or 15 years is gathering research through qualitative in-depth interviews with participants around their personal experiences of long-term conditions. And this is part of a worldwide consortium of researchers. So I'm just to recap, I'm talking about the sort of research work that we've done over the last 10 or 15 years, where we interview people about their personal experiences of long-term conditions. And these are rigorous, systematic, qualitative research studies, and they're the same as any qualitative research study that you would do. The difference is that we use these data and analyse the data that we gather to then make publicly available topic summaries, which would be, if you're a qualitative researcher, would be based along the lines of themes, thematic analysis. And these topic summaries are illustrated with video clips from the video recorded interviews. And if people don't consent to video clips, they do consent to audio or even just written transcripts. So I wanted to give you a very quick tour through a couple of our websites. So the first one that I'd like to show is the HealthTalk Australia site. What I'd like to show you is, yes, this is the HealthTalk Australia site. So on this site, you can see that it has a number of modules. I'm not sure that I've actually got control over that. I'm just scrolling down to show people. We've done a number of different research projects. If you click on the aging, just back up a bit, there's the aging module on the right-hand side. If we click on that, you will see down the left-hand side of that screen, there are a number of, under overview, there are a number of different topic summaries. And we, if you click on one of those, if we click on, say, the business of living, and in there, there's a whole lot of different, so you could click on, say, interests and activities, and that should bring up, scrolling down a little, there is there's a series of video clips that you can click on that are drawn from the research that's been conducted into these different conditions. If we just scroll back up, so that you'll see these two clips that you could click on have been anonymised. These people didn't want the video to be shown, but they're happy for the audio to be played. So we still make these people's stories available, but we do it at the level in which they are comfortable. If I could now show you the healthtalk.org, the UK website, I just wanted to show you that because that was, they have done over 100 modules, and it has a similar setup whereby you can find a particular condition. It might be anything from arthritis to cancers, all sorts of different conditions, and you can again on the left hand panel find a topic summary relating to that particular condition, which is based on the thematic research that we've done. Then you can click through there and you can find video and audio recorded clips. So in the interest of time, I'd love to be able to take you for more of a tour, but I know that we're up against time here. So what I'd like to do now is go back to showing you the consent and copyright forms. The consent form, and you should be able to open this and have a look at this yourself because I've made these available. Please note they're copyrighted. The consent form is a standard consent form as you would have for any ethics-approved study, and it outlines the usual ethics-related issues around giving consent. Participants can also tick a box to indicate if they give consent for video or audio recorded sections of the interview. So the consent form, just as you will see, it's very standard that people consent to understanding the purpose of the study, they've read the participant information statement, they've had any questions answered, they can withdraw from the study at any time, that their personal information is collected over the course of the project, is stored securely, that they are happy to be, they can tick a box to show they're happy to be identified, or they don't want to be identified and they want their identity to be anonymous, but they wish to have the transcript of their interview identified under a pseudonym, which they can then write in, and that they consent to audio, video, and or reviewing transcripts. So that's just the standard consent form. With the copyright form, this is the more important one, I guess, or the more relevant one for our listeners today. So this is a copyright transfer form, and I'll just take you very quickly through this. So it's about future use of my interview, and I intend that my interview will be available to the HealthTalk Australia website, that the study investigators have approved it for use in teaching, broadcasting, research, the making of audiovisual resources and other publications. With this particular form, it's also available on the Centre of Research and Excellence in Severe Asthma website, and that it will be the material may be shared with academics, broadcasters, developers of training courses, website developers. You can see that it's quite comprehensive. On they can also remove or retract their copyright. They can, if I decide that I no longer want my interview to be used, it will be removed. But I'd like to stress that this very, very rarely happens. In the thousands of interviews that have been done using this method around the world, there would only be a handful of people who change their minds later on, and we will, wherever possible, we can definitely remove it from the website, but if transcript data has been used in publications, of course we can't remove that. The final thing I would like to say is that people do give consent for video and audio recordings. They willingly do that, and they usually say it's because they hope that it might help other people who are in a similar situation to their own. And once we show people how the websites work, for those of them who are a little unsure, they will, most of the time, they will then consent to having their interview video recorded. A small percentage don't consent, but then they do consent to the audio and the transcription.
Thank you very much, Lorraine. We are going to now pass over to Anne.
Good afternoon, everyone. Although I'm here in Perth and it's still morning here, so nice to talk with you all. I want to just quickly tell you a little bit about what we're doing here in Western Australia and, of course, you know, across the country, wherever the opportunity presents itself. As Kate said, I run a consumer and community involvement program across all health research organisations, universities, tertiary hospitals in WA. And our program was established originally in 1998 at the University of Western Australia, and then a couple of years later at the Telethon Kids Institute, particularly in response to community concerns about the linked data capability that was being established in West Australia in the mid-90s. And then, you know, people were concerned about research being done without consent and people didn't know. So the university decided with great foresight, I should think, to put in a consumer advocate a day a week. And that's now gone where we had one person working one day a week. I started in 2004, and we now, as a result of funding our Lottery West here in WA, we have a team of 10 people working to support consumer and community involvement. So the whole aim of our program is to support the community voice in decision-making about health research priorities, policies and practice. Now, a lot of work that we've done over the 15 years that I've been here has involved research that's used linked data. So been a lot of conversations, a lot of concerns, and I'm really pleased to say a great shifting of the landscape. So the sort of the services that we provide to consumers and to researchers is we provide advocacy and support for involvement with community links and evidence base. And the big thing that we do is offer teaching and training for researchers and community members. We've got a network of over 1,800 members, and I think probably about 1,500 of those are consumers and community members that are involved in having a say in research. We've got a website, it's called Involving People in Research, and I would suggest perhaps you might like to have a look at that after this. So in relation to the changing landscape that I mentioned, between 1998 and 2005, when people talked about linked data research, they talked about things like this is Big Brother in action, people don't know their information is collected and research is conducted, people aren't told about the results, the data could be hacked, WA Public is not informed about data linkage, and so on. There was a lot of concern when I first started, and I'd actually worked in health previously for about 15 years prior to coming into this job. And I worked as a consumer advocate, and I had never heard that we were establishing a linked data capability. So, you know, people were a bit nervous about it. But I'm pleased to say through a whole range of activities, I've really seen a change in attitudes. And in 2015 and 16, we went back to people who raised those concerns about their, you know, Big Brother and their privacy, etc. And we asked them, did they still have the same concerns? And a couple of people, and I'm talking, you know, I went back to about 30 people who were originally involved in 2000 and 2004. And a couple of people said, you know, things like if a researcher uses our data, you know, he or she is under a moral obligation to help that data improve our lives. Researchers are using linked data and still never talk to a patient, a carer, or an actual human being. And we're not sure data linkage processes meet the gold standards of transparency and accountability. So there were a couple of people who still were a bit nervous about it. But the bulk of people that we talked about had really changed their attitude, having been involved and in a whole lot of awareness-raising activities. And you know, said that things like health data has proven to be secure from health from hacking to date. People are very relaxed about sharing intimate data on things like Facebook and Snapchat and things. So what's the problem? Why don't we use the information that we have to drive good policy without, you know, and stop politicians and people with vested interests hijacking the debate and hiding behind the privacy issues? And why aren't governments, and this was the biggest thing, that government collect data, you know, on a range of things, and although my experience is all in health, there's lots and lots of data collected, and people felt that governments have got a real responsibility to use that data to make a difference to people's lives. So I suppose basically what I've seen is the big shift from, you know, privacy concerns right across the board to saying, you know, what we want now is the data to be used, and good governance is about what will ensure that people's privacy is protected. So I just want to quickly run through some of the things that we've been doing. As I said, we run training workshops, and approximately 400 community members have attended training workshops that always include a topic on linked data capabilities in WA. And I have to say, I have never had anyone say after attending one of those training workshops that they're still worried about, you know, the capability of using linked data. And in actual fact, people very much see that using anonymised data is privacy protecting. So we have numerous community members currently serving on projects that use linked data in a range of activities, reference groups, and I think, you know, currently we've got about 410 consumer and community members sitting on research committees, decision-making committees across WA, and a lot of those projects use linked data research. Community members have had input into submissions around the use of linked data for research for both state and federal government submissions, and, you know, always that has been very positive. And then just very recently, we brought together 25 senior consumer and community members and reps to be involved in priority setting for future research using linked data. And that will be looking at social determinants of health across the life course, preterm to death. So again, you know, we've seen really positive changes once people have an understanding of what it's all about. I just like to finish off with really saying that what I think is a greater community awareness of the benefits of data sharing. I think not enough is done to explain to people how, you know, the community can benefit from the use of big data. There needs to be a lot more community dialogue around the secondary use of data, and particularly with my health records coming on board, I think that that's something that people have a tiny bit of nervousness about. And I think researchers need to work together in partnership with community members to address these concerns. And I, of course, would like to see greater involvement of consumer and community members in all research. And we're talking about the decision making about what is research, how it's conducted, and the translation of those findings into policy and practice. Just lastly, I'd just like to leave you with this. I think this quote is fantastic, and this is from one of the people that was quite nervous in the beginning, and she really came around to see the benefits of it. But her thing was that she said, "I know the data is anonymised, but I want you, the researcher, to remember that it's my story. It's about me, my life, my family. Researchers should honour that by making information available to everyone about what the data is used for and what is found." And I just think that that says it all. Use the data, but actually do the right thing and tell me what you're using it for and what you're going to find. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Anne, and that's a really good point to end on. It's fabulous. So I'm just going to quickly show a few slides from some research that I've been looking at about people's attitudes to the secondary use of health data. So Research Australia came out with this report earlier this year, and they're a national alliance representing the health and medical research sector. They do an annual survey about health and medical research. And this year, it showed that 93% of their respondents supported the use of health record data for research purposes. But I do note that this survey didn't specify whether that data was identifiable or not to the people who were in that survey. So a study commissioned by the Wellcome Trust, which is the UK's version of NHMRC, asked respondents how willing they would be to allow their medical records to be used in a research study if the information excluded their name, date of birth, address and contact details. And in 2015, the proportion of very willing or fairly willing was 77%, and in 2012 that was 60%. So that shows an increase in willingness, as Anne was talking about. In New South Wales, the Information and Privacy Commission report from this year found that 58% of respondents agreed that they were willing for their identifiable health information to be used for research purposes. So remember the first one I discussed, that it didn't specify whether it was identifiable or not. This one specified identifiable, and I wonder if it would be higher if they had specified non-identifiable, like the UK one. So there's a really great website from the UK. It's owned by the Wellcome Trust, and they have a collection of information of studies about patient views on health data reuse. They also have things like information about words to use when talking to patients about data, and how to engage with the public and patients about issues around use of patient data. I really recommend this website. It's a very good one to explore. And Anne also touched on this in her talk. The My Health Record is going to be compulsory for all Australians from next year. We're all going to get a My Health Record, and currently the government for the next month is running a consultation on secondary use of data and developing a framework for the use of this. So if anyone is interested, now is the time to be able to put into that consultation. There's online consultation, and there's also some workshops that are happening around the country. So have a look at that if you're interested in that. There's a few references here. Don't worry about writing them down. The slides are going to be available on the ANZ website after this, but that's just for further interest for people. So I just wanted to quickly sort of sum up what I felt the takeaway messages that we were speaking about today are, that there is support from people about using their medical data for research, but be aware that it's not 100%. And as Anne said, it's really important to engage with the people who you're working with and with consumers. Appropriate consent is important, and as Lorraine touched on, levels of consent for data sharing may be an option for your research projects. Thank you very much for your time today, Anne and Lorraine, and everyone who has called in to watch our webinar. We've got one more health and medical webinar about the Australian Health Thesaurus and data linkage, so hopefully we'll see people there.